Welcome back to Paul's Tech News. We have a slightly shorter show today because I need to hit the road, briefly, and then I'll hit the sky, flying on up to the Great White North to say buenos dias to my Canuckian friends over at Linus Media Group, as well as all the well-heeled attendees of LTX, which should be going on right now if all my plans do not go awry. But despite my little corner of the tech world being abuzz with excitement over the Canadian convention this week, there were other things going on in PC hardware news too. AMD has a new and quite affordable 6-core AM5 CPU hitting the market, although getting your hands on one might be tough, and there was a flood of new GDDR7 and high-capacity DDR5 memory news that might just help you forget how hot it's been this summer. Thankfully, by the time you see this, I'll be chilling north of the border where it's way cooler. So, vaya con Dios, as they say in Canada, it's time for tech news.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by Thermaltake's CTE series cases, the C750 Air and C750TG. CTE stands for Centralized Thermal Efficiency, and the 90-degree rotated motherboard mount, dual-chamber design, and three included 140mm CT140 fans ensure that your PC parts stay cool and quiet no matter what hardware you install. The C750 Air maximizes airflow with extensive ventilation, while the C750TG provides an additional 4mm tempered glass front panel, and both support up to EATX-sized motherboards. For more on Thermaltake's CTE series cases, click the sponsor link in the video description. It seems like as soon as I claimed that the summer would present us with a lull in new hardware launches, new hardware began to launch. And while the new GPUs that have oozed onto store shelves leave much to be desired, AMD bucked the trend by launching an intriguing US-exclusive budget gaming CPU in the 5600X3D for AM4 motherboards earlier in July, and then followed that up with the $180 Ryzen 5 7500F that launched globally Monday. Technically Sunday. It is also technically available worldwide, although retail versions will only be available in China. For other areas like the US, you can get one by buying a full PC from a system integrator, or presumably by ordering from alternate channels such as AliExpress once more CPUs are on the market. Reviews have been pretty positive for the 6-core, 12-thread AM5 CPU, which is basically a Ryzen 7600, clocked 100 MHz slower and without integrated graphics. Or the ability to be overclocked easily thanks to a locked multiplier and a 65-watt TDP. Still, the 7500F is $50 cheaper than the 7600's MSRP, and compatibility with more budget-oriented A620 chipset motherboards, which don't support overclocking anyways, makes it a compelling choice for a gaming PC and a foot in the door on the AM5 platform. Hopefully AMD will be producing enough of these so they can be picked up standalone by DIY PC builders without too much of an import tax. We interrupt this episode of Tech News for some live updates here from LTX 2023, mostly live. I'm here with Pedro, PC Master Race. Pedro, we have some news out of China. Can you tell us about the new graphics card that has been announced?
Yeah, apparently they announced an RX 7900 and they call it GRE. Do you know what that means?
GRE. GRE, that's not an XT or an XTX. What's it stand for?
It isn't. It stands for Golden Rabbit Edition.
Golden Rabbit Edition.
Some peculiar specs. So okay. You have 80 compute units, have 16 gigs of RAM, coupled with a 256-bit bus.
256
on a 7900.
That's less memory and a narrower memory bus than the other 7900s. Why are they still calling it a 7900?
I'm not sure.
I'm not sure either. The good news is it's only going to cost $650. The bad news is it's only going to be sold at retail in China. So an interesting launch here in midsummer from AMD. But thank you, Pedro, for the special report. And Paul, back to you in the studio. Speaking of new PC hardware, we are once again poised on the precipice of another shift to the next generation of graphics card memory technology, and all the big players are getting in on it. It began a little over a week ago, last Wednesday, when Samsung officially announced their industry-first GDDR7 memory chips. So suck it, GDDR6 and GDDR6X. What, you think just adding an X to something makes it cool? It actually does not. Usually a bad idea, I would say. But Samsung's GDDR7 features 16 gigabit memory modules and up to 1.5 terabytes per second of bandwidth, 40% more than archaic GDDR6 with its piddly 1.1 terabytes per second cap. GDDR7 modules could get even faster too as manufacturing methods are refined, as has happened in the past. So yes, there might be GDDR7X at some point too, as long as they don't just start calling it X memory. Forget that, because it's memory. Forget that, because it's memory. Not to be outdone, Samsung rival Micron announced their own GDDR7 memory 1 week later, on Wednesday, and to prove that they are better than Samsung, they also announced HBM3 Gen 2, HBM Next, and the first ever 32-gigabit DDR5 memory dies, which they say will be used to build 128-gigabyte modules and up to 1 terabyte DDR5 memory sticks that should launch in 2024. Meanwhile, the Micron GDDR7 for video cards will come in 16 and 24 gigabit dies, and WCCF Tech conveniently put together a list of what GPU memory configurations would look like using the new VRAM. 12 gigs on a 128-bit bus providing 512 gigabytes per second of bandwidth, all the way up to 36 gigs on a 384-bit bus with a nice 1,536 gigabytes per second wide pipe. Or what the heck, 48 gigs on a 512-bit bus. Just saying. And I think my editor might have just busted a nut. But don't you bust that nut just yet, there's still the more rigorously paced tech briefs segment to get through. I'm sure you can hold out. Or at least, you might show better stamina than many PCIe 5.0 SSDs have been displaying recently, as a whole spate of them have been failing due to overheating. The drives in question are all based on the Phison PS5026-E26 controller, and to be fair, they all stopped working when they were run without the heatsink that they ship with. Some Corsair MP700 drives were the first casualties reported, but other models from Crucial, ADATA, Gigabyte, and Seagate have now exhibited the same behavior. A firmware update is now available that will throttle the drives when they overheat instead of allowing them to fail, so take note if your drive is affected, and also note that those heat sinks on PCIe 5.0 SSDs are there for a reason. They didn't just put them there to look cool. That's what the RGB LEDs are for. Many of us are still recovering from the great GPU shortage of 2020 through 2022, but another threat to our video cards looms on the horizon. AI. It's apparently coming for our jobs and our GPUs, according to Wang Xiaochuan, businessman and founder of the Chinese search engine Sogou. ChatGPT's current GPT-4 model uses several thousand AI GPUs from NVIDIA, and it is reported that around 20,000 units have been sold to them directly. If Mr. Xiaochuan is to be believed, ChatGPT is already at work on a new AI model with vastly more advanced training methods, which could connect as many as 10 million AI GPUs together. That's a lot of manufacturing capacity that would be devoted to producing said GPUs, perhaps putting the squeeze on how much fab time is given to consumer video cards, which sounds bad for gamers. Oh, and a global network of 10 million GPUs learning to think for themselves seems vaguely ominous as well. Segueing back to more reasonable tech news, it appears that AMD's 3D V-Cache technology will at last be appearing in a laptop. A Weibo post shared on Twitter by @9550pro indicates that Asus is preparing an ROG Strix SCAR laptop featuring a Ryzen 9 7945HX3D. 7945HX3D is quite a mouthful. I guess they couldn't quite fit a full 7950X3D, so they had to go with 5 less. It would be interesting to see what performance boost AMD's 3D tech can bring to a mobile device, and barring some sort of Asus exclusive, we will likely see other laptop vendors bringing devices to market with the new chip as well. And what the heck, here, I'll kick things off for everyone with an ad spot. I don't always game on a laptop, but when I do, I prefer the 7945HX3D. Rolls right off the tongue. Speaking of things that are difficult to say, Asus is making those dumb power cable-free video cards, even though I called them dumb in a very clearly labeled video. Reports from China, as relayed by WCCF Tech, are saying that Asus will be going into production for these cards, with a white one at least, and they'll be RTX 4070s, and they'll launch in the fall. The blasphemous news was vomited into reality at the Bilibili World 2023 exhibition in Shanghai, China this week, and will apparently offer consumers the ability to pay extra for a GPU that will limit their motherboard choices, force them to buy a new case, and hamstring their upgrade options, all for the sake of hiding the shameful fact that their graphics card requires more than the 75 watts provided by the PCI Express bus. What a bold step forward for PC builders everywhere. So like I said guys, a shorter show this week, but thanks to everyone who has come up and said hello during LTX. The Canada trip is all the travel that I have planned for a while, so August for me will be all about finishing up remodeling projects at home and getting moved back into the newly renovated garage studio from my office. More on that whole project coming very soon. But there you have it, guys, tech news for the week. And if you liked it, click that like button, or you can leave me a comment down below. While you're down there, all the articles I talked about today are linked in the description if you're interested. And you can also check out my store at paulshardware.net for high quality merchandise, t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, and more. Subscribing to my channel is always a good call too. Thanks again, everyone, and we'll see you next week.